All right, well, good morning, everybody. Thank you for coming. As you know, this is the last of our courses for modules 1 and 2, and then we'll take a summer break and resume in the fall. And appreciate your participation these many weeks. In fact, take a look at the last page of the materials. I was just looking back myself as I prepared these materials. I'm on page 4, section 4. And, you know, we only started this in February of this year and have covered a lot of ground. We've covered in depth 4 Pauline epistles, Colossians, 1 Thessalonians, Galatians, and Corinthians, 1 Corinthians. We're looking now at the prayer books, history, and structure. And then, of course, you all have your memory verses that you've been practicing on, no doubt. And then we've taken a pretty in-depth look at various aspects of Saul's life over these weeks. Included a little history of the Ember Days and the critical role that the laity play in the Ember Days in praying for the clergy and those who are about to be ordained. And then just a few vocabulary words thrown in. That's not an exhaustive list by any means, but you know, that's a lot of ground to cover, and I appreciate you all participating so faithfully, and certainly appreciate your questions as we've gone along. So, I have been battling a bit of a bug, and I told Andrew this morning that I took took a Benadryl this morning, and those things really make me a little loopy. So I promise not to get too crazy on you. Hope I won't, but I may have a little bit of the sniffles as we go. Let's open in prayer in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen. O Lord, we beseech thee to keep thy church and household continually in thy true religion, that they who do lean only upon the hope of thy heavenly grace may evermore be defended by thy mighty power, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. I promise that I have not become obsessed with this issue of the Holy of the Holies, which came up about 2 weeks ago. We talked a little bit more about that last week, but it was natural because if you've been reading the daily office scriptures, Friday morning's second lesson was out of Hebrews. And I can't attribute this very first mistake. I hope it's the only mistake I made in these materials. In section 1A, I messed up the scripture references, so if you have a pen or pencil, make a correction. But where it says Exodus 24, that should be Leviticus 16, verse 15. And the citation to Hebrews should be chapter 9, verses 1 through 14. Chapter 9 of Hebrews, verses 1 through 14. And the first one is Leviticus chapter 16, verse 15. And I just found that this scripture from Hebrews tied in so well, of course, with the cycle of readings that we're doing regarding Easter, the resurrection, Jesus' role as the great high priest. Well, that goes back to this. There are many passages, but a key passage that's referenced from Hebrews is a reference back to Leviticus chapter 16, verse 15, and I'll just read this. It's not too long. So this is what would happen now that the tabernacle's been constructed and the sanctuary and the Holy of Holies have been constructed according to the very detailed instructions contained in Exodus that God has given to Moses. Then shall he, and this would be the great high priest, shall kill the goat of the sin offering that is for the people and bring his blood within the veil. So he goes from the sanctuary into the veiled area. That's the Holy of Holies, where the ark is, right? So he'll bring the blood within the veil and do with that blood as he did with the blood of the bullock and sprinkle it upon the mercy seat and before the mercy seat. Well, the mercy seat was really essentially the lid of the Ark of the Covenant. So he's sprinkling this blood of the goat as a sin offering for the Hebrew people. And only the great high priest can do that. Well, then, fast forward to Hebrews, this section from, it was Saturday morning's second reading, and I won't read the whole thing here, but there are two kind of interesting, particularly interesting passages. We talked a little about it, but what was in the Ark of the Covenant? We get an answer in chapter 9, verse 4, and it says that the priest went within the second veil, which is called the holiest of all, which had the golden censer and the Ark of the Covenant overlaid, that had manna. Remember the manna that fed the Israelis as they were wandering through the wilderness? The Aaron's rod. Aaron's rod had kind of supernatural powers. It was used for a variety of things, from turning the River Nile into blood to striking water, to holding, allowing the Israelites, the Hebrew people, to be victorious in battle as long as Moses could hold his arms up. But that wasn't with the rod. Take that back. And then there was the golden pot that had the manna, Aaron's rod, and the tables of the covenant, the Ten Commandments. So that was what was in the ark. But anyway, later in this passage from Hebrews talks about Christ being come and high priest of good things to come by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not with this of this building, neither by the blood of goats and calves. By his own blood he entered into once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. And there's another passage that gives me chills to think about. God ordained this sacrificial process thousands of years before Christ came along, and it was a type. And now we see that type fulfilled when Christ entered into the Holy of Holies and with his own blood offered sacrifice and atonement for our sins. What a tremendous bookend in Scripture. And so the only other comment I wanted to make about that is, in the lectionary, well, really kind of two things. Excuse me. We didn't really talk about this in the first two sessions on the prayer book, but the lectionary is sort of divided into two main sections. You have what some people call the festal portion of the year, and then the non-festal portion. The festal portion really has to do with two pieces, Christmas and Easter. So for the Christmas portion of the lectionary, you have Advent, Christmas, and Epiphany. And for the Easter portion, you have pre-Lent, Lent, Passiontide, and then Eastertide, leading up to Whit Sunday or Pentecost. And so you'll find in the lectionary, and this is another reason why I wanted to point this out on this reading from Hebrews, the readings from the Daily Office lectionary are, in large part, tailored to the time of the season in the festal portion of the year. In other words, the readings for Advent focus on Christ's birth or his second coming. The readings in Easter, if you've been doing the Daily Office readings, you see that they're so heavily focused on Christ's resurrection, in this passage from Hebrews, his atonement for our sins. And so they're very thematically related. And so you don't always read in a very linear fashion through particular books of the Bible. Whereas in the latter half of the year, which is essentially the Trinity season, which that's our season is purple, is green for Trinity, you tend to read the scriptures in a more linear fashion without being tied into a particular theme. So kind of keep that in mind and look for that, particularly as we finish up Eastertide, why they've selected the passages that they've selected. Another thing I wanted to mention, I think it was 2 weeks ago, His Grace mentioned, I think it was in the context of his comments about the prayer for Congress. Maybe this was last week. You know, it's highly recommended in morning and evening prayer if you can. Sometimes you can't, but to say your prayers out loud. That helps you to pace your prayers. It helps you to focus your mind a little better rather than just reading them silently, which you tend to sometimes sort of rush through them a little bit. It's hard enough sometimes to keep your focus even when you're reading them aloud, but I think that's a great suggestion. And second of all is be patient and be persistent. You know, saying the daily office can get dry. It and that's probably unavoidable. But A, it's important that you do it. B, sometimes we'll never see the results of our prayers in our lifetime. We can't judge the effectiveness of our prayers or whether God's hearing us by external signals sometimes. But it's still important that we say these prayers. God hears us regardless, and they're answered one way or another. These prayers are answered. So don't become discouraged if you sometimes say, oh, you know, I just don't know if this is really worth the effort or not. It's worth it. It's been proven through centuries and centuries by people who are holier than I am that it's well worth it. Any questions or comments up to this point? Yes.
Just in this morning's reading, and I can't remember which of the second one, but it ends, you know, whatever you ask in Christ, in Jesus' name, you know, He will give it to you.
He will grant, yes.
I've always remembered that, but
whatever you ask in name, my name, I will grant.
Yeah.
Verse, that promise has puzzled holy people, church fathers, theologians for many, 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 many centuries. But it is a promise that He made. And we have to rely on that. And oftentimes, as I said, we can't see that that's really happened. You know, there certainly have been things that I prayed for very earnestly that never came about. Never. Well, that doesn't seem to be consistent with what He said. I am not theologically astute enough to be able to give you a great answer on that, other than you have to believe what He said and rely on that promise. Remember in morning and evening prayer, the prayer of St. Chrysostom, Almighty God, who has given us grace at this time, with one accord to make our common supplications unto Thee, and His promise that when two or three are gathered together in My name, Thou wilt grant their requests. That's where that phrase comes. Remember, the prayer book is all paraphrased or actual scripture. We rely on that, and we believe that. And sometimes we just don't see that being quite answered the way we thought it should be answered. But maybe His grace would like to weigh in on that, but it's a conundrum. Yeah. So very briefly, I always say that and I lie. Two major objectives today is to look at the collects, epistles, and gospels, or the propers. So they're called the propers because they're chosen for the particular day or part of the season. So they're proper for the mass that's to be celebrated on that day. These are the variable portions of the mass, and those are the collects, epistles, and gospels. Now the fixed portion of the mass is what we say every Sunday, and that's just pages 67 through 84. You'll need to grab your prayer books because we'll be taking a look at some pages. But 67 through 84, you're all very familiar with, that's the fixed portion of the Mass. And then immediately following, starting at page 90, are the propers. And these follow the seasons of the year. And I have listed, if you'll skip back to page 2, section D of the handout, you'll see the liturgical year set out into the headings that appear in the prayer book and the liturgical colors associated with each of those seasons. So right now we're in Eastertide, and the associated liturgical color is white. And I think we've got about two more weeks to go, two, 3 weeks before we switch to red for Whitsuntide on June 9th. So if you kind of stay right around page 90 right now, these collects and epistles and gospels are quite old selections. Most of these go back to, I think I say here, the 6th and 7th century from the Roman Church. So the lectionary that we read on Sundays in large part parallels what is read in the Roman Catholic Church. There are some differences, but like last Sunday was Good Shepherd Sunday. That is the same in the Roman Catholic Church. So as Christians, as the part of the Catholic Church, even though there are denominational differences, there's a large agreement on the lectionary each Sunday, and those selections are quite ancient and time-tested. The Gospel recounts a portion of the life or the teaching of our Lord. The Epistle is selected expressly to sort of contained an apostolic or prophetic exposition of what you just are about to hear in the Gospel. And then the Collect gathers up both of these lessons into prayer. And so what you see mentioned on back in the fixed portion of the Mass, it says, here's where you say the Collect of the day. Well, that's the Collect that comes from these variable propers. Page 90 and following. A collect of the day is a short prayer appropriate to the day of the church year and one which collects or sums up the thought of the day or season said in the Holy Communion service in connection with the reading of the Epistle and Gospel and also in morning and evening prayer and the other services of the prayer book. Many of the collects in the prayer book were written well before the 1549, the first prayer book. They were appropriated into the prayer book. Quite a few were written by Thomas Cranmer himself, and there's a sizable number that were written subsequent to 1549 and have been incorporated as well. But by and large, these collects are quite ancient, and you're going to see that in a second. You may not have noticed, but collects have kind of a rigid structure. As here in section D3 on page 1, it's a several part structure. You have an invocation. So usually the prayer is addressed to God or to Jesus. Most often to our Father or to God, the Father. Then you have some statement of doctrine or of some gospel fact as the ground on which a petition is based. And then you have usually a single petition. And then you have a mention of what you're hoping for as a result of that petition. And then you have a conclusion. And there's kind of a rule that you follow on the conclusion that if the prayer is addressed to Christ, our mediator, the conclusion when the prayer is not addressed to Christ, the mediator, it's always through him. And so, most of our collects will end through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And then you'll have a little doxology, such as, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. But that structure is very closely followed in the collects. So, take, for example, today's, I don't know if you have your service leaflet with you, but if you turn back to Easter 3, which is page 173, the collect that we said today, you can see how this pattern has been followed. So you have the invocation, and that is Almighty God. And then you have a statement of doctrine or gospel fact, who showest to them that are in error the light of thy truth, to the intent that they may return into the way of righteousness. That's a gospel fact that we've gleaned from today's readings. And then you have a single petition. Grant unto all those who are admitted into the fellowship of Christ's religion, what? What benefit do you want? That they may avoid those things that are contrary to their profession and follow us all such things as are agreeable to the same. And then you have the conclusion. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, amen. And you can see how that follows the pattern exactly. So you can go home with this little structure and write your own collects. You really can. I mean, I've done it. I did it in anticipation of my ordination. I wrote a little collect that I prayed every day. And whether it was any good or not, I don't know, but I did it. And it's pretty easy to do. It's kind of fun to do. By the way, this is one of the oldest collects in the prayer book. This goes back a very long time. And it clearly refers to the newly baptized in that phrase. Where is it? Grant to unto all those who are admitted into the fellowship of Christ's religion. That's the reference to being newly baptized. So it's appropriate for being one of the colics shortly after Easter when baptisms are often done. We've already talked about in section D on page 2 the sort of liturgical year breakdown and the colors associated with those. In addition to these propers for basically the Sunday Masses, you have a number of propers. This is in section E, those that are appointed for holy days, Ember days, Rogation days, marriages, burials, etc. The colors often vary, but so much of the time we are commemorating a martyred saint. And when those calendars are printed, historically they're printed in red type, thus the phrase red letter days. We're supposed to be impressed by that. And there are numerous other collects, epistles, and gospels that are embedded within the specific regular. Remember, we have the regular services and the occasional services. Morning and evening prayer have their own specifically designated collects. Baptism, ordinations have specifically designated. But 90% of the time, we're looking at those that are appointed for the liturgical year. Then we have, as a separate category, we talked about this just real briefly last week, sort of the additional collects. And those are in two sections. There are the prayers and thanksgivings that are at page 35 through 53. And I think the prayer that we said for the president and all in civil authority comes from that section, doesn't it, Your Grace? Can't remember. I do know the prayer for Congress that we were saying last week was adapted from the 1662's prayer for the High Court of Parliament. So that makes sense. Here's a prayer that was being said in 1662 for the British Parliament, and it was just changed slightly to be applicable to our Congress. There's a prayer for the Courts of Justice. The 1928 prayer book was the first prayer book of any of the Anglican prayer books to include a collect for the courts, and they could use the help. The prayer for rain, this is G1C on page 2. It's interesting, that prayer for rain was written expressly by Cranmer, and it's not changed a bit since then, and it was kind of considered a little controversial. That's at page 40, and unfairly. And this, Connie, goes back to your question. Well, sometimes we pray for things that don't always happen. Here's a prayer for rain, and the objection to including that among some clergy and scholars and theologians was it seemed like you were sort of trying to make God a puppet on a string and make him, we need rain, send us rain. And so, but the answer to that is, well, why not? You know, we're commanded to pray by Jesus, whatever you ask in my name, I will grant your request. Well, if you need rain, then ask for rain. There's no reason why you would not do that. That's not being selfish. That's not being kind of like trying to treat God like he's some sort of trained animal. It's a need that you have, just like your spiritual need. He is as concerned about our temporal needs and our temporal condition as our spiritual condition. So there's nothing wrong about praying for those without it. Overly selfish attitude or other improper motive. And for the sick and the afflicted, I won't go through this, but just want to point out to you that there are about two or three prayers on pages 45 and 46 that are excellent to use when you have either yourself or friends and family who might be in need of special prayers because of challenges they're going through. Take a look at all of those prayers. Read through them, you'll find them, I think, very, very helpful. And then there are the additional prayers that are at the back of the prayer book, pages 594 through 600. Again, this is really just sort of continuation of the prayers and thanksgivings earlier in the prayer book. These were added for the first time in the 1928 revision. Just point out a few here. For the spirit of prayer at page 594, I like to say this prayer before morning and evening prayer. It just sort of invokes the, uh, Almighty God, who pourest out on all who desire the spirit of grace and of supplication, deliver us when we draw nigh to thee from coldness of heart and wanderings of mind, that with steadfast thoughts and kindled affections we may worship thee in spirit and in truth through Jesus Christ our Lord. Just a nice tone setting and mind focusing prayer to say before you actually get started. The prayer for to be said at night. I just love this prayer. It's just so lovely. O Lord, support us all the day. Page 594. O Lord, support us all the day long until the shadows lengthen and the evening comes, and the busy world is hushed and the fever of life is over and our work is done. Then in thy mercy grant us a safe lodging and a holy rest and peace at the last. It's almost a poem. It's so beautiful. Another one, nice to say just before bedtime. For quiet confidence, I just noted here that this prayer, page 595, was written by the Reverend John W. Suter, Jr., who, if you look at the certificate of the prayer book in your prayer book, he is the custodian of the 1928 prayer book, or was up through the 1940s at least, and he contributed a number of collects that ended up in the additional prayers section. For those we love, at page 597, a really nice intercession for your family and for your friends. I try to think about this prayer, particularly on Sunday mornings, just to bring those who are dear to us to mind and to pray for them. And then finally, the prayer for those in mental darkness at page 598. This one's interesting because it was suggested to the 1928 Prayer Book Revision Committee by a laywoman who was concerned for those who could not or were not inclined to pray for themselves because of mental disease or defect or mental challenges. And very thoughtful of her to include a prayer for those who can't or won't pray for themselves because of their present mental condition. So just a lot of really lovely prayers to browse through at your leisure. That's a quick survey of the collects, epistles, and gospels. Any questions or comments? Okay, well, we'll turn to the Psalter. And I just like this lengthy quote to start off this section. The Psalter is longer, more frequently quoted in the New Testament, and more extensively read in the lectionary than any other Old Testament book. Since the time of the Church Fathers, if not before, it has been considered a summary of the teaching of the entire Old Testament, or even all of divine revelation, together with a comprehensive description of all the states of the soul in the presence of God. The Psalms continue to be the living heartbeat of the Church's prayer to the present day. I just really thought that was an excellent summary of the importance of the Psalms and why we continue to recite them every morning and evening. By far, as this indicates, these are the most read and most recited portions of Scripture in the Bible because they are so comprehensive and so complete. You all know that there are 150 Psalms. I'm sure that's become obvious to you. A little less obvious may be that it's broken down into five books. Those books are actually noted in the prayer book. If you look, for example, at the end of Psalm 41, that would be on page 92, 392, I believe. Yeah. Notice verse 13 is, "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, world without end. Amen." You can always tell when a book is at its end because the last verse either ends with Amen or Amen and Amen. Page 392. Each of these books, again, it's probably a little hard to pick up on this when you're doing the daily offices because you don't get the flow as if you were reading these in one long sitting. But each of these books has been broken into various themes, and they're listed here at the top of page 3. Book one is sort of an introduction in the laments of David. Book two addressed the rise of the Davidic kingdom. Book three addresses primarily, not always, the fall of the Davidic kingdom. Book four contains reflections on the fall of the kingdom and exile. And by the way, this is considered the most, of all of these books, this is the one that seems to be where the theme really sticks all the way through. And then book five is rejoicing and restoration of the temple. And there are of course, exceptions within these, but these divisions have always been recognized, and they're longstanding, and when you're reading the Psalms all the way through, they help you to kind of understand why you're reading some of these Psalms that seem to have such a common theme. The word psalm comes from the Greek word psalmos, for song, and interestingly, they have been uniformly considered to be canonical, meaning they're held to be inspired by virtually all Jewish and Christian traditions. So you're not going to get into fights over, like you might on some of the prophets or some of the apocryphal books. Everybody within the Judeo-Christian heritage really agrees that the Psalms are canonical, therefore they're inspired. It's nice not to have to fight about that. They're poetry, but unlike English poetry, it doesn't rhyme. Really, it's built, for the most part, on what's called parallelism. If you look at Psalm 2 on page 345, one form of parallelism, and this is getting a little down into the weeds, and we're not going to take it beyond two examples, is called synonymous parallelism. So if you read verse 1, why do the heathen so furiously rage together, and why do the people imagine a vain thing? Well, verse 2, the kings of the earth stand up, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed. Those are two verses that are coupled together with a very similar thought. And so they are parallel to each other. And that's called synonymous parallelism. Contrast on that same page, Psalm 1, verse 6 and 7. Therefore the ungodly shall not be able to stand in their judgment, neither the sinners in the congregation of the righteous. But the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, and the way of the ungodly shall perish. Here you have proposition A and the opposite of that proposition, and so that is called antithetical parallelism. So that's really all you need to know, but those are probably the two most common types of parallelism. So look at pairs of verses. Do the two seem to express the same thought? That's synonymous parallelism. Do they seem to express antithetical thoughts? That's antithetical parallelism. That is a very large part of the Psalms. Nothing that you need to know other than it's kind of interesting, but that's what their form of poetry is. It's not rhyming. There are some other psalms that have different structure. Down on E6, there are psalms that are acrostics. In other words, each verse starts with the first letter of the Hebrew alphabet. So that's another form of poetry. Again, it doesn't rhyme, but it's probably you did some of that in grade school as an assignment. Confidence psalms, imprecatory psalms, that's an important category for our purposes in that you just need to know that what that really means is there are certain passages in the Psalms or entire Psalms that call down a curse on one's enemies or ask for God's vengeance on one's enemies. And those are the imprecatory psalms. Those in some of the more modern lectionaries are left out. And I think that's too bad, because If the Psalms are canonical and they are inspired as we believe, then you should read them all. And when I read the imprecatory Psalms about God, slay my enemies, crush them under your foot, I read that very spiritually. I think of the demons and the devil who's trying to ruin my life. That's who I want God to crush underfoot and to throw out and to slay. And so David and the others who composed the Psalms believe that that would be ultimately the outcome. There would be victory over these enemies. And so why would we not read those portions just out of a sort of a sense of political correctness and choosing not to read portions of Scripture that really ought to be read. Anyway, and then the other major category in number six there are the Messianic Psalms, and we could spend numerous sessions just looking at the Messianic Psalms, but I think, Your Grace, did you quote this today? Maybe not. I don't think you did. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Jesus spoke that from the cross, right? That comes right out of Psalm 22. There are numerous psalms that either are quoted by Jesus or referred to by Jesus. And so it's clear from our looking back perspective, as we've said many times, the Old Testament foretold what was to be fulfilled in the New Testament times. This is clear now that we look back how Jesus used the Psalms. I think in section G4, we'll talk about the superscriptions in just a second, but I want to really make clear here in G4. We often talk about the Psalms of David, but not all of the Psalms are attributed to David. Only about 74 are attributed directly, where it'll say, a Psalm of David. Now, unfortunately, or maybe it's not unfortunate, but the prayer book version of the Psalms does not contain what are called superscriptions. But if you look in your King James Bible and any other translation, pretty much, they'll say a Psalm of David, or a Psalm of Asaph, or a Psalm of Solomon. So those Psalms have been attributed to specific individuals. Well, 74 of those are attributed to David. But in G4, there are several examples in the New Testament where Jesus and Luke and Paul and the author of Hebrews all refer to Psalms as Psalms of David, even when they're not attributed specifically to David by that superscription. So my point being, here you have Jesus quoting Psalms. Well, then why did David say such and such? And he quotes a psalm that doesn't have that superscription, a Psalm of David. My point being that they are largely attributed to him, but not exclusively. There's hot debate over when the Psalms were written. Clearly, some of them are pre-exilic psalms before the Babylonian exile in 597 BC. Clearly, there's a lot of scholarly consensus on some of these psalms that are without doubt composed by David and properly attributed to him, and probably some of these others attributed to the other individuals are properly attributed to them. Some of the psalms are clearly post-exile, post 597 BC, so David couldn't have written those. He wasn't around, so nobody argues about those. But it's just, I think, interesting that the New Testament refers numerous times authoritatively to the Psalms to make a point or to explain why Jesus did or said something in his life. I think I've sort of made the case about why we should pray the Psalms because of what we've just talked about, but I'll inflict you with one more quotation, which I just really liked. These prayers, above all others, remain essential to the worship of the church because they are the only prayers we possess that are both inspired by the Holy Spirit and prayed by Jesus himself during his earthly life. In the language of later Trinitarian theology, one could sum it up this way. The Psalms were, one, inspired by the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity; two, prayed by Jesus Christ, the second person of the Trinity; and three, offered to the Father, the first person of the Trinity. In this way, Jesus, praying of the Psalms, consecrates them as a special entry into the life of the Trinity. I just really love that concept. And we talked last week, I think, about how we always say the Gloria Patri, glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, at the end of the Psalms, is another way of sort of Christianizing those Psalms and making them part of our Christian life. Yes?
Is the Te Deum wrote almost a Psalm of David?
The Te Deum is not. It is a later hymn that was composed as early as the 4th century. Nobody really knows who wrote it, if there was any single author.
It's so beautiful.
It is glorious. But that's one canticle that we don't say the Gloria Patri after, because it already has such praise to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost built into it. It would be superfluous to say the Gloria Patri after that. But it came along later. But the Te Deum is beyond description beautiful.
We always sang that at morning prayer.
Yeah, it's common to do that, yeah. I skipped over section E on page 3, the types of psalms. What I would encourage you to do is to look up. I gave you an example of each type: lament, thanksgiving, royal psalms, wisdom psalms. Just look at each example. I think it will become very obvious to you why these examples fall into the category that I've given you. Perhaps when you're reading the psalms in the daily offices, with a little bit of this background about what type of psalm is this, what book is it in, you can do a little detective work and maybe have a little deeper appreciation of what it is that you're reading. Very briefly and last, the psalms in the prayer book, I think I've mentioned earlier, are the ones that were translated by Miles Coverdale. They appeared for the first time in 1535 and were later included in the Great Bible of 1540. They weren't included in the original 1549 prayer book. They, in fact, weren't bound with the A prayer book until 1662, as a matter of convenience, really, more than anything. And that's continued to be the tradition for all Anglican prayer books. But they remain the Psalms up to our revision in 1928. There were, as I noted here, about 100 corrections or revisions made to some of the wording, but they are 99% still Miles Coverdale's Psalms from 1535. How do you read them? You have two options in the daily offices. You can read according to the schedule in the daily office lectionary. And this harks back to what I said earlier about the scripture lessons are often selected to sort of be consistent with the season of the year that you're in. So the psalms that are chosen for much of the first half of the year are chosen for the season you're in. That's one way to read them. You'll still read them several times throughout the year if you follow the daily office lectionary. The other way to read them is set forth in the Sedona Rite, which is the version of morning and evening prayer on our website, which our bishop put together, and is entirely not only permitted by the rubric, but it's really kind of more ancient than the daily office lectionary, and that is you read through the Psalms once every 30 days. And so I'm sure you've all noticed in the Psalms themselves there are divisions that will say morning. Here's 8th day morning prayer. So you read all those psalms. I'm looking at page 387. You read all those psalms over to page 391 and stop where it says evening prayer. Well, if you do that every day, every morning and evening, you're going to read through the psalms in 30 days. And in months with 31 days, you repeat the 30th day. Actually, you could read any psalm you want to. The rubrics allow that, but that's kind of the tradition, to just reread the 30th day. So those are your two options. I have a little quote on page 4 from St. Athanasius a observation that he made, that the Psalter contains prayers for every possible occasion of a Christian's life. And that is reflected, and I know I've mentioned this page before, that's reflected on page 9 of the prayer book, entitled Selection of Psalms. And those categories probably fit about every occasion of your life that you would need a particular psalm for. So that's really kind of a great reflection of what Athanasius was saying. In section J, I've included a link to an 11-hour YouTube, which is really fabulous. It's an English choral version of the entire Psalter sung beautifully. There's no attribution to who it is, but whoever it is, they're the real deal. It's pure, beautiful, right out of the prayer book, Anglican chant. And they've broken it into 30 days, morning and evening. But every psalm is hyperlinked. So if you wanted to hear the psalms for this evening's lectionary sung, you could click on the hyperlink for that evening, and it's beautiful. Try it out. Right. Ah, yes. You're right. Now, do you have a question or was that a comment?
Also, and there's so much of the text on Messiah and whatever, whenever you see that, you're kind of like, well, I do the nations,
You know more scripture than you think you do when you hear it sung, don't you? Yeah, exactly. It really boom. Yeah. Well, our service doesn't really include a psalm selection. So if we were doing morning prayer, we could, if we had somebody capable of serving in the role of a choir. But just, and I'll get to you in just 1 second, Gloria. And to your point, you can open to any page here, by the way, it doesn't matter. Just open to any psalm, and you'll see these little asterisks. There are three ways to read the psalms and sing them. These were pointed for singing by Cranmer. Cranmer, very early on. I think it's in the 1549 prayer book or 1552 that the psalms were specifically pointed for singing. So typically what would happen is one side of the choir would sing the port of the verse before the asterisk. The other side of the choir would sing the latter half of that verse. So you'd have antiphonal singing. Another way to do it is alternating verses. If you go to the cradle of prayer and listen to morning prayer being said, these priests will say one verse, the cantor would recite the next verse. That's another way to do that. Or you can recite them together. So it's really, there's a lot of debate over which is the best way, and there's no rubrical right or wrong way. It's what does your parish traditionally do? And do you have a choir to be able to do that? Yes. Gloria?
There is a CD called Odeo Gloria,
okay,
which concerns the choir of a Anglican church in Connecticut on that piece that goes out in the ocean.
Oh, the little on the little hook on Connecticut?
Yeah, what do you call it?
I don't know. That's not Cape Cod. What is that? The hook that goes out into the ocean at the bottom of Connecticut.
That's where this church is located.
Okay.
It was built, I think, in the 80s, and there is a 30-voice choir that does nothing except sing the psalms.
Wow.
And the CD is for the whole thing. I'll bring it and let you look at it.
I'd love to hear that.
It's fabulous.
Yeah,
fabulous. Good. Choir and fabulous.
Good.
See, you hear psalms that you've never heard before,
yeah,
but they sing all of them.
Good.
This 30-voice choir.
Excellent.
And they're
well, that's the end. So hopefully in these first three sessions, I mean, we've looked at where did the prayer book come from, what things were assembled together to make the prayer book, and then last week, of course, going through the sort of nuts and bolts of morning and evening prayer, what were certain parts called, and how do you do it, and then the propers for the Mass, those collects come into use in morning and evening prayer. But we've kind of set the stage now for the highlight of the prayer book, and that's Holy Communion. And that's what we'll take up in the fall. But I hope that that's given you a little bit of a background on the prayer book that maybe you didn't have. And as always, if you have questions, email me. Follow St. Luke's on Facebook. I don't think we have any saints coming up this week, but we had some last week. I don't know if I mentioned one of my favorite saints. I'll close with this. St. Monica. This goes back to 1B2, be persistent and patient. You know, St. Monica prayed for years for the conversion of her scalawag of a husband and her lazy and shiftless son, St. Augustine, later St. Augustine. And finally, many years later, her husband converted and was baptized. And very, very late, she died shortly after, I think, Augustine converted, but largely because of her many, many years of what must have seemed like fruitless, wasted prayer. But it bore fruit in the end. So keep at it. Be a St. Monica when it comes to prayer. And let's close with prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. O God of peace, who has taught us that in returning and rest we shall be saved, in quietness and confidence shall be our strength, by the might of thy Spirit lift us, we pray thee, to thy presence, where we may be still and know that thou art God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thanks, group.
Thank you all for coming. Thanks for putting up with my rambling.
Did you ever think about putting together a quiz?
For the whole...
Yeah.
Yeah, I actually have.
Because... I think